much, and welcome to another hour of Georgia Championship Wrestling, and what an hour we've got upcoming. We're going to be seeing the great Kabuki in action a little bit later on, and I'll be talking to Gary Hart in just a moment. The tag team combination of Kevin Sullivan and Wayne Ferris will be in action. Also, Wildfire Tommy Rich will be seeing the Super Destroyer and Superstar in an Australian tag team match. Right now, let me take an opportunity to welcome back to Georgia Championship Wrestling after having missed a fight connection last week, Rod Piper. Welcome back.
Thank you very much, and it is a pleasure to be back here, of course. I'm sorry I missed last week, but I didn't realize how much demand there was for me. I'm glad. I've had all kinds of letters that asked me to come back and lend my expertise to the ring, and it's just a pleasure to be back here with you, Mr. Sully.
And a pleasure to have Rod Piper with us. And right now, let me take a moment to bring in another gentleman who is highly controversial. I'm referring, of course, to the millionaire playboy Gary Hart, the manager of the great Kabuki. And Mr. Hart, I understand a little bit later on in the program we're going to get an opportunity to see your man in action in a series of matches.
Going to have an opportunity to see the great Kabuki at his very best, so you can understand and have the true knowledge of what Kabuki is all about. But I would like to say something. I missed you myself last week. You were out here with the Dean of Sportscasters, and you are doing a commendable job. And I was sitting in Dallas, Texas. I turned it on Super 17, and you weren't there, and it bothered me.
Mr. Hart, coming from you, that's a true compliment, and thank you very much. Because right here, we have the master of them all, Mr. Gary Hart, and it is a pleasure.
Well, all right, gentlemen, thank you both very, very much. Mr. Hart, we'll be talking to you a little bit further.
I have to go get Kabuki ready.
Precisely. All right, sir. Gary Hart going to get the great Kabuki ready for his matchup coming in just a few moments. Right now, then, we're set for our first match, so let's turn it over to our ring announcer.
Ladies and gentlemen, this event, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. One fall, 10, from Riverdale, Georgia, at 241 pounds. Here's Marvin Turner. Marvin Turner. His opponent, from Tampa, Florida, at 235 pounds. Here's Jim Garvin. Jim Garvin. Your referee is Scrappy McGowan.
Okay, Scrappy McGowan, your official now, and it is Jim Garvin in the light blue trunks going up against Marvin Turner in the dark blue trunks, and it is Turner battling him off as Garvin had pulled him back into the turnbuckles. Garvin, of course, has bulked up extremely well, has a great upper body strength, as you can see. Turner, good, solid, beautiful move by Garvin as he got behind his mat, slid behind him, gave him an atomic knee drop. Turner, having that spinal column jammed that time, back on his feet and begins to circle Jim Garvin once again. They're squaring off collar and elbow into a hip lock takedown.
What power that Garvin had in executing that. Did you see that? That man must be 250 pounds, 260 pounds, and lifted him up above his head just with brute strength. Fantastic. Now you can notice he's got the headlock. Notice the feet spread apart very well. All the weight on the man. Very good, very good.
And so Marvin Turner has his problems now as he attempts to regain his feet. Jim Garvin moving with him now as they come up into those ring ropes, and the referee calls for the break. Clean break by Turner as he steps back. Now Garvin gets set to move in on him once again. Collar and elbow, and again Turner taking the aggressor here as he gets the side headlock. Drop toe hold by Jim Garvin. Floats up on him and goes to the side headlock once again.
Smart thinking there on Garvin's part. You notice this man here is built high. In other words, his power, you notice, is from waist up. Now, what Garvin did is he wanted to use the headlock, which is working on the upper part of the body. So in order to get him there, what he did is gone for a leg trip and got him down to the mat, which is the weakest part on this man from what I can see, and then went for the head. Good thinking, good scientific wrestling.
Head of front chancery, and the referee, as they got into the ropes, called for the break. So Garvin circles his man once again. Garvin began as an amateur wrestler when he was about 11 years old. Did extremely well. Suffered a broken arm in amateur competition, but that did not deter him. He continued to compete. Went on to the state finals. Did extremely well, using the back of the elbow that time against the base of the skull of Marvin Turner. Brings Turner up, full body slam, and as you said, Rob, shows that once again great upper body strength.
Absolutely, very strong individual, but I wonder now, lacking a little aggression. You see, now when you got a man against the ropes like he did right there, he's going to execute, I don't know what a backdrop. Now cover him, now cover him now. You see, he's giving that man recuperation time. That's something you can't do. It's time for him to get aggressive and not let him breathe for a moment.
And it is Turner caught with a forearm by Jim Garvin, and Turner rocked by that one, dropped to the canvas, and it is Turner His face wreathed in agony right now as Garvin closes in on him once again. Overhooks the head, brings him up high. Souffle, Turner in a lot of trouble here as that had to jam the neck and the spinal column. Count of three. And so Jim Garvin, reappearing here in Atlanta, scores a victory over Marvin Turner. Well, as we mentioned, of course, at the beginning of the program, Mr. Gary Hart is here along with the Great Kabuki. But before we see the Great Kabuki in action, I wanted to bring Gary Hart back and talk to him, because we're going to have an opportunity now to watch the Great Kabuki in a series of matches that have been videotaped.
Mr. Soli, if you wouldn't mind, I would prefer the honor to interview this man myself, because I have some points with the Great Kabuki, and I would like to talk with Gary Hart. If you wouldn't mind, could I do it myself?
Sure.
Thank you very much, Mr. Soli. Just excuse me. Mr. Hart, I'll just say it's a pleasure here, because as long as I've been associated with wrestling, if you talk about wrestling, you talk about Gary Hart. And you know the ins and outs, and you have a gentleman here named Mr. Kabuki that I have never seen anything in my whole life like it, and it's a tribute to you and a compliment to your, not only to your style, but to your brain power, what you've done with this man.
You know, you are an amazingly intelligent young man.
Well, thank you very
much. To realize that someone is that great. I mean, you must be a world traveler yourself. I mean, you've been everywhere, I'm sure. I've heard about you all over, come this country from Scotland, if I'm not wrong, right?
That's right, Mr. Hart.
And I hear you play the bagpipes just beautiful. Sometime would you do that for me, please?
I certainly would. I'd be pleased to right now.
Kabuki loves bagpipe music. Did you know?
No, I didn't know that.
They play a lot of that in Asia, a lot of bagpipe music.
I would like to look at a film of Mr. Kabuki, and if you would, just tell me a little something about him. I've been watching him closely.
That'd be terrific. As you can see here, Kabuki is wrestling two individuals. So you see a thrust kick behind the head, catches him with the elbow right into the solar plexus, thrust to the side of the head.
You notice he doesn't get excited, even when there's two people on him at one time. Doesn't get excited. You must have trained him to keep composure.
To be honest with you, the man has got an ability that if it was eight or nine people out there, it wouldn't make that much difference, you see.
What a machine. What a machine.
Now watch this. This is beautiful.
Oh! That was great.
That was a thrust right up above, right into the chest area, as you can see. One, two, three. Put that one away.
Fantastic. You notice the man was completely out. He didn't even have to grab a leg there.
Watch this. This is great. Caught him with a thrust kick coming off the top rope.
I've never seen nothing like that.
He's amazing, isn't he?
Truly is. You must have spent a lot of time, and what it is your managing qualities is great. You must have a great fighter, but you have to know somebody that can handle him, and you are definitely the best. Is this a three?
This is a three, I'm sure.
Oh, very good.
Once he lays that in, they don't get up.
Poetry in motion. Mr. Hart, you must...
Look at this. This is one of my favorite situations. Look at that. Yep. Bruiser Brody, 295 pounds, probably the toughest man in professional wrestling. But watch, Kabuki's going to get him one more time. I want everyone to remember. That is Bruiser Brody, 295 pounds, probably one of the greatest wrestlers that ever lived. But Kabuki got him down.
Three. Well, it couldn't have been. Could might have been one of the greatest, but not the greatest. Because Kabuki just obviously proved that, Mr. Hart. You're obviously at ringside here, are you?
Oh, yes.
I want you to know that it's an honor to find somebody that has the intelligence in wrestling and knows science and can take somebody like this and do this with him and guide him along his path. It's a credit to you, truly, as a manager, and I guess that's what makes you number one.
I think the only person that could probably do that other than myself would be a man such as yourself.
Why, isn't that nice? It's such a pleasure to have you out here in here. I'd like a little more about yourself.
Gentlemen, I hate to interrupt, but I think we'd better get on with the matches. I appreciate very much you coming out, Mr. Hart, and I appreciate you handling the interview.
It's been my pleasure, Mr. Hart.
My pleasure. Nice talking to you, too, guys.
I've enjoyed it. Thank you very much. Let's move on to the ring at this time in our next match, which is already scheduled to go. All right, Vinny. Valentina moving out there against Rick Harris. Harris in the black and Valentino out of Florida State University.
I know something about this Rick Harris here. Now, here's a competitor. Here's a man that's 270, 275 pounds that can move. Now, you see, it's hard to find yourself. You can find big men that are strong. You can find fast men that are small. But to get a combination the same with strength and ability, this Rick Harris has a lot to offer right here. So notice right up to his feet there. Boom.
Harris wearing a protective covering on the knees and on the right elbow. And, of course, this becomes a primary problem in wrestling, the proclivity for Matt Burns. And Matt Burns, of course, not only are they painful, but can very quickly lean to infection if you're not very careful with them. So both of these men showing the marks of their profession.
Yes, truly. And you know, another thing with Matt Burns is it's something that's constantly on your mind. It's a tiny pain that's on your mind because it's not the kind of pain of getting hit that gets numb immediately. It's one of them kind of just itching, grabbing pains that makes it hard to concentrate. Oh, nice hip lock there. Get to your feet, young fella. Couldn't keep his composure. Rick Harris there. Now, he's not doing anything illegal. He hasn't used one punch, nothing. Those are forearms, and he's using the point of the elbow into the solar plexus, which, Mr. Soli, is sometimes stronger than actually hitting with the fist because you get more power.
Well, you do get that advantage of the extra leverage. There's certainly no question about that. Harris now with a rear chin lock on Vinny and keeping Vinny trapped in that rear chin lock. Vinny trying to get back to his feet now, does. Uses the elbow into the rib cage, again to the rib cage, off the ropes. And caught his man, but he was also caught momentarily. And again, Harris drives that knee to the midsection.
Look at the ham hocks on Harris. I mean, look at the legs on him. You know, legs like whiskey cakes that fellow's got. They're afraid of nothing. Never stops coming ahead, even when someone hits him. Here he comes more.
And so, Vinny Valentino taking a lot of punishment here as Harris closes in once again. Snapmare that takes Vinny back to the canvas, once again into a rear chin lock, and perhaps a little bit low with that chin lock. He looked like he may be coming across the throat. The referee moving in to check. And Harris either moved it or else he is not across the throat.
Now you see how the elbow of Mr. Soli is placed in the center of the back? That's just for a little extra leverage because what he's trying to do is cut blood off from the head, and pushing the elbow in the back keeps him off balance, pulling the head back, not keeping his balance and gravity just perfect up and down, which is very smart.
Top wrist lock, and Harris getting some extra leverage that time, and slipped by the referee, I might point out. And, of course, it's extremely difficult. Officials have, I think, no matter what sport they're in, the toughest job in the world because they've got to have eyes in the back of their head to keep up with everything that goes on.
Absolutely. But, you know, from the fights you have here, the wrestling matches and the top wrestlers you have the best officials, I think, that I have ever seen any place because they're men now that have been trained, have gone to school, and learned how to fish, and they know what these guys are up to, and they're right on them. See that? Yeah, he's not going to fool them twice. Fantastic official.
Caught him and called for the break on that, and Harris, on a technical point, did in fact break the hold. It was a momentary flash of breaking the hold, but he did in fact break it. And so Harris now caught with an elbow in the rib cage, another elbow in the rib cage, and another one, and now Vinny comes out. Beautiful flying drop kick puts Harris back to the canvas. And but the match has taken its toll, and Vinny may have injured his legs on that one. It's a dangerous situation. Harris now brings him up into a full body slam.
That's where the fight comes out. Sometimes I'm so hurt and so down that I can hardly, my wind is knocked out of me. I can still get to my feet and come on back. I think that's what this fellow in the yellow is lacking a little bit. Because he lacks that, just that heart. Oh, very good counter. Nice suplex.
I'll go it out.
One. And that's a three. Very good touch.
Caught him and well executed, extremely well executed. We'll try and take a look at that once again in slow motion. And Rick Harris emerging victorious in that particular event. Let's watch this now as he tried to set him, used that forearm very effectively. Now watch Harris as they come off the ropes. It's Harris using the rope as a springboard. Then he tried to set him, but as he did, he was saltoed by Harris as he tried to set him for a backdrop. Well executed by Rick Harris, hooks that far leg and scores the pinfall. Tomorrow night, here at the Omni in Atlanta, it will be Nature Boy Ric Flair, the world heavyweight champion, defending his title against Tommy Wildfire Rich. And the Great Kabuki, managed by Playboy Gary Hart, takes on the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes.
Let me say something, Dusty. Tomorrow night, the Omni, Atlanta, Georgia, I'm gonna end it for you, brother. I've been chasing you for 7 years. And I've got a special Christmas present from you from Singapore. It's gonna come a few days early. I'm gonna put you down. And this time, you ain't getting up and you ain't gonna walk. The Omni, believe it.
Thank you so very much, Playboy Gary Hart. Kabuki going against Dusty Rhodes. Other great matches will be held around the country, and here to tell us about it is Freddie Miller.
Thank you, Gordon. Tonight in Chattanooga, 8:30 Memorial Auditorium. Next Monday night, Augusta, Bell Auditorium at 8. Next Thursday night, Gainesville, Georgia, the Georgia Mountain Center. It starts at 8. Next Friday night, Gadsden, Alabama, the Coliseum at 8. On Sunday, December 20th, back to Marietta, the Cobb County Civic Center, a super card. And what about tomorrow night? Tomorrow night, 8 o'clock, the Omni in Atlanta, the big one for the World's Heavyweight Championship. Nature Boy Ric Flair, champion, against Wildfire Tommy Rich. Grudge match, the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, against the Great Kabuki. National Tag Team Championship, Brad and Bob Armstrong, champions, against Kevin Sullivan and Wayne Ferris. Austin Idol against Michael Hayes. Terry Gordy against El Grand Apollo. Buzz Sawyer against Ray Candy. And a special attraction tag team event. Bad Bad Leroy Brown and Big Red against Superstar and Super D. It happens tomorrow night, 8 o'clock, a great card, the Omni in Atlanta.
Certainly another great match tomorrow night will be when Austin Idol goes up against the original Freebird, Michael Hayes.
Original? Did I hear you say original? Well, you can look at a Michael Hayes and buy a Michael Hayes for a dime, a dozen, at any drugstore from here around the country. You know something? There's a whole shrouded issue here. Everybody here is literally coming to me and saying, Austin Idol, when are you going to shut his mouth? When are you going to show him once and for all who's the prettiest, who's the sexiest, who's the richest, who's the meanest, who is the toughest, who is the greatest of them all? Well, darling, it's going to be in the Omni, it's going to be Sunday, it's going to be the 13th, and Hayes, believe you me, you belong to me.
Well, we're going to have an opportunity right now to see the great Kabuki in action. He's going up against Bubba Carr. Bubba Carr, an exceptionally fast competitor in the ring, and Mr. Hart on his way. Mr. Hart, I wonder if I could have a word with you just for a second before you go to the ring itself. You know, there's been a lot of talk and so on and so forth, but your man is not the only man who holds a license on certain things, and I thought you might be interested in hearing some comments at this particular point in time from the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. These are videotaped comments, and if you'll just stand by, we'll take a look at the monitor.
Kabuki. Are you an assassin? Are you a soldier? Are you an errand boy? I think you're an errand boy, my man. Gary Hart declared war on the American Dream. Dusty Rhodes. Gary Hart is the assassin. I will come for you both. Kabuki. Wow. No titles. No prestige. The end of Gary Hart. The end of Kabuki, for I am the assassin this time.
comments.
Let me tell you one thing, Dusty Rhodes. You don't paint your face and become Kabuki. Who do you think you are? I'm an assassin. He's an assassin. You are an assassin. I'll tell you one thing, you little chubby kid from Austin, Texas. You paint your face. You do whatever you want and you talk as much as you want. Because on Boogie Street in Singapore, only one man paints his face. Now, I hope you're watching today because I'm going to show you what Kabuki's going to do to this man he's wrestling. And I want everyone to know that what we do to him is because of you, Dusty. We're going to hurt him bad because of you, Dusty. The man paints his face. Kabuki will wash it for you. Nobody insults Kabuki that way, Sully.
Well, very irate. Gary Hart expressing his views and his comments and his retort to the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. And in fact, we're going to see the Kabuki right now in action against Bubba Carr. This match, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Kabuki now removing his outer garments, and in just a moment, he will have the chainmail removed from his head. And as he does, he is set. And there again is that strange green fog that he is able to emit from his mouth. I frankly, the comment you just heard, Rod Piper saying, how does he do that? I frankly don't know. And apparently it has some sort of toxic effect. Now, ooh, boy, did he catch him that time.
Ooh, what a kick right to the midsection. Oh, to the side of the head. Very, very good. Now, this is a style of fighting you need. Look at the aggressiveness there. A blow with the backside of the hand, not to hurt the knuckles on the man's head. Cut. What sweeping kick to the midsection. He caught him right from the very beginning. This is the kind of attack you need. You see, notice Playboy Gary Hurt constantly on him, making him just look at that is incredible.
Has him caught into those ring ropes now, and Bubba Carr has had his problems out of here. Chances are that he may have been somewhat intimidated before he stepped into that ring, and Kabuki, and it was difficult to see how he was reacting to what he saw, except in looking to his eyes, there was certainly a steely glint that indicated he was more than somewhat unhappy over Dusty Rhodes' painted face, if you will. Catching a pressure point now in the armpit area, and Carr's in trouble.
I see anger in Kabuki from what he's just seen. I seen a man who's been insulted. I seen a man who's right now out to prove a point, who is doing nothing but demolishing this opponent. And if I've ever seen anybody ready for Dusty Rhodes, I see one there right now. I don't think he's going to stand a chance, Rhodes.
Well, Kabuki, of course, if I know Playboy Gary Hart, is ready for anybody at any time. And there he moves along the second ring rope. Crashes down into Bubba Carr once again. A count of three, and it is all over for one Bubba Carr. Kabuki in that strange movement once again as this match has ended, and now it's a problem here momentarily, and Gary Hart has his own problems sometimes handling Kabuki. Kabuki still so angry that he doesn't want to leave the ring, and it is Hart out there very quickly. And now Hart leading Kabuki away. And so we have here indeed a very, very bad situation. We're going to be turning here momentarily to ringside. And Rod Piper will be interviewing the National Tag Team Champions, the Bob and Brad Armstrong. Rod?
I must say, it's a pleasure to be with you gentlemen again, the National Tag Team Champions. And I hear now, all kinds of things have happened for you, gentlemen. One, you have gone out and bought yourself a nice brand new Corvette to date a few ladies. Is this the case?
Exactly right, Mr. Piper. You know, I'm very fortunate to have a car like that. And Dad and myself are also very fortunate to be those National Tag Team Champions, and we hope to hang on to them for a long time.
And you went and you bought yourself a nice $20,000 car and spend all that money. Does it bother you at all that possibly with lack of management. You know, there's a lot of fighters like yourself who go out and make a name for themselves and make a lot of money, and then all of a sudden just go and blow it, maybe from lack of direction from your dad or lack of direction from some kind of manager. You're going to spend all your money and end up one of those broken old fighters. You know, it's an interesting question at someone of your young age.
Well, Mr. Piper, you know, you learn by your mistakes.
Yes, but maybe if you make those mistakes, possibly you won't have a chance to correct them. If you go and spend all that money, you may not. Maybe you get hurt or something. You've got nothing. You go out and buy yourself a $20,000 car. What do you do? Is it lack of direction? Is that what the problem is? Of course, sir. Is it lack of direction? No, Mr. Armstrong, is it lack of direction on your part to your son not to save his money instead of going and blowing it on a Corvette, taking out young ladies?
Let me say this. I believe, Mr. Piper, that every man must do what he thinks is right. Now, if I was 19 years old and I had won that much money, a Corvette would be the first thing I bought because I've always wanted one. I think that everybody must make his own decisions.
Okay, that's very good. But I'd like to ask you, seeing that you seem to be speaking up here and saying, I'd like to say something about Mr. Kabuki now. Being one of the martial arts, I have never seen anybody more vicious in there. I've never seen anybody more on the attack, more professional with Gary Hart and exactly what they're doing. And it would be an interesting challenge just if anybody would take it, but it doesn't seem that nobody really wants to put their name on the contract.
Well, you know, Kabuki is a kind of a weird individual, and...
No, I didn't say weird. I said he's very aggressive.
No, I said weird, and I mean weird. He's got his thing going. He paints his face. He tries to psych people out with a painted face. Well, Indians did that hundreds of years ago, but it didn't psych anybody out, and I don't think it's psyching. You know, I know a little bit of karate myself.
I'm saying, I understand that you were with the you took martial arts. You were in the service. I understand that you're an expert in martial arts. Kabuki is an expert on martial arts. Now, all of a sudden, we got two experts on martial arts.
I've never said I'm an expert. I say I know enough to get by. I don't claim to be a master. Those people where he's from, Singapore, those kids from the time they're 2 years old until they're adults are trained in martial arts. I've never had that. I trained a little in the Marine Corps. I know enough to get by. But I'll tell you this.
Are you afraid of them?
I am not afraid of anybody walking, and that includes who I'm standing with. Let me say this. I've never seen anything work, martial arts or anything else, as good as an all-American right cross, because when you hit a man right, brother, he's going to go down. But I'm not afraid of Kabuki, and I'd welcome a match with him anytime. He can use his karate, kung fu, boogaloo, whatever. And as far as Mr. Gary Hart, who you seem so fancy with over there, Mr. Chrome Dome, he's been the most evil manager. He's always had weird people, and right now he's got Kabuki, who's the most weird individual I've ever seen in my life.
Oh, I think that's quite. I think I finished interviewing you. Thank you.
I'll tell you this. Let me say, in your case, Mr. Piper, it's kind of like mind over matter, and that means that I don't mind and you don't matter.
Yes, well, it's truly been a pleasure, Mr. Armstrong, and it's off to the horse races again for you, Mr. Armstrong, I guess. Heroes and zeros is what we've got here, and it's been a pleasure.
Ladies and gentlemen, this tag team event, one fall, with a 10-minute time limit, one fall 10, from North Carolina at 210 pounds. Here's Keith Larson. Keith Larson. His team partner from St. Petersburg, Florida, at 214 pounds, Tom Rogers. Tom Rogers. Their opponents after the National Tag Team Championships, introducing from Boston, Massachusetts, at 235 pounds, here's Kevin Sullivan. Kevin Sullivan. His partner, ladies and gentlemen, from Memphis at 265 pounds, Wayne Ferris. Ferris.
Wayne Ferris and Kevin Sullivan going up against Tommy Rogers and Keith Larson. And that is Rogers moving out first, collar and elbow very quickly now with Ferris. Ferris now goes to the side, headlock. Hey, did he slip away from that beautifully? And Ferris very quickly used those ring ropes to escape from that hold. So apparently Ferris is his own kind of ring general.
Yes, the gentleman with the dark hair's name is...
That's Tommy Rogers.
Tommy Rogers, very, very astute athlete. Good, look at the fellow with the blonde hair there, a little heavier, a little top heavy there. As you see, he's got punk rock listed on his back of his wrestling tunic. I'm not sure what the significance of that is. And then I'd rather listen to Lassie bark myself. And that nice tag got Kevin Sullivan. Now here is an athlete, now, a couple of athletes. Wouldn't you agree, Mr. Soley?
Well, Kevin Sullivan is a tremendous athlete. He was a state champion in the amateur ranks. Oh. And more. Wow, and boy, we've got a Pier Sixer erupting here as these two men throwing away the rule book momentarily. Sullivan using the flat of the foot very quickly. Sullivan has a mean streak that runs from the tip of one shoulder to the other shoulder and from the tip of his head to the tips of his toes. He is mean all the way through. Makes the tag with Wayne Ferris. Ferris back into the ring.
Absolutely beautiful. Did you notice the aggression? Did you notice the style that Kevin Sullivan had when he came in there? Not being reluctant at all, came right in there. No, he's not sitting there waiting for the referee to say, break, break, break now, boys. It's time for a nap. He's getting in there and getting the job done, and that's what you need. Look at that. He saw his partner was in trouble, got the tag. Now, I'm anxious to see what he does here. He watched. I don't know if he saw that tag or not.
All right, Rogers moves back out now, gets a side headlock. Sullivan almost slipped away. Sullivan bulls him back into his own corner. Where he and Ferris double team on Rogers temporarily and momentarily. Now it's Sullivan again. We've got a four-way melee going now with Larson and Rogers out there with Sullivan and Ferris. All four men in the ring at the same time. The referee trying to restore order. And look at the double teaming now. Double teaming on Rogers. And it's Sullivan.
Gets
the pinfall. Kevin Sullivan gets the pinfall, and might just point out, Kevin Sullivan just set a record in deep lifts, squats with 425 pounds. He did this in a repetition of 26 times, a new established record. And Mr. Ferris, congratulations to you and Mr. Sullivan.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sully. And you're looking at the National Tag Team Champions. That's what we do best right there. We win. One, two, three.
You know something, Gordon? As I've said before, the class rises to the top. Everybody in this area is probably some of the greatest athletes in wrestling today. I'm not going to take anything away from Bob Armstrong and the Clone, but there's no way. And that team, you know who's the weakest one? It's the old man. Because I know if I had a kid and I saw him getting hit, it bothered me. So Armstrong, we don't have to worry about your boy. We know he can take handle it. It's you that's going to crack, and we're going to get those national belts.
The national champion!
Well, thank you very much, gentlemen. Some interesting comments from a Dynamite Tag Team combination, Kevin Sullivan and Wayne Ferris. We'll be back. Tommy Wildfire Rich going up against Tony Russo, and may I just point out that Tommy Wildfire Rich has set himself an interesting regimen for the past 7 days. He has wrestled just about anybody and everybody, trying to once again improve on his total versatility in the ring. And in facing a battled veteran like Tony Russo, good head scissors by Rich, he is facing could be the ultimate in what he is gunning for. Obviously, Tommy Rich would like to gain that World Heavyweight Championship, and he is definitely choosing opponents that will give him a total variety in opposition, so that his attitude, I would assume, when he steps into the ring with a champion, has to be one of total confidence and complete experience.
Very, very good, Mr. Soli. And that's what a fighter should be doing. But I've been studying Tommy Rich, and there's one, of course, you know, I'm qualified to be able to comment on some of the faults he's got, because I have been a world champion myself, and I know what it takes now. And Tommy Rich has got everything together. He's fighting a variety of people, so he's got a, you know what his problem is? Is he loses his temper. What his problem is he'll get hot. A man now, it takes a while now, not just any man. Now, he can beat 99% of the wrestlers. Of course, I am 1% of them right now. He can beat almost everybody. But the problem is he loses his temper in the ring. And he must learn to control that when the times are getting tough, because that's what's important. You lose fights when you get mad.
There's certainly no question about that. The fact is that you've got to maintain your cool. As we've said so many times, it's human chess at its very finest. And if you allow the emotions to creep in and interfere with logic, then you can. You'll make that mistake, and all of a sudden, in that twinkling of a three count, it's all over, and you've lost the match.
Absolutely. And watching like you have, and your knowledge of wrestling, Mr. Soli, you know that I'm telling the truth, and it's going to be something. You see, you can overcome a technique of a drop kick if you're not doing it right. You can overcome the technique of a punch, but you cannot overcome something that's inside you. You're trying to change metabolism, and that's very hard to do.
That's well, once again, doing. Self-discipline, self-sacrifice. Beautiful vertical body block by Tommy Wildfire Rich. Tommy Wildfire Rich reverting back to that vertical body block and did it so, so well. And let's take a look at that again if we can, and we'll see exactly what we're talking about. Tommy Rich, as you see him there coming off the ropes, into the air, a good high vertical body block, stuns, notice the way he hooks with the legs, keeping the weight of Russo forward to the shoulders, and that, of course, enables him to score that count of three. Tomorrow night at the Omni here in Atlanta, the NWA World Heavyweight Wrestling Champion and the man who I feel is destined to become one of the all-time greats, Ric Flair, defends that title against Tommy Wildfire Rich. And this has to be your toughest challenge here in the state.
Well, there's no doubt about it. Tomorrow night. You know, in the eyes of all the ladies all over the world, I have been a champion for a long, long time. Going on 4 months now, I've been wearing this gold belt. And tomorrow night in the Omni, Tommy Rich, your dream, your illusion, is all going to be reality. Because it means you have to walk that aisle. You have to get in the ring with Ric Flair. And you have to prove to all these people you've been talking to that you can beat me, Tommy Rich, tomorrow night. I don't think so, baby. The Nature Boy will beat his best, and you will be mine all night long. Thank you, baby.
Thank you, Ric Flair, NWA World Heavyweight Champion. And now, for a look at wrestling around the rest of the country, here again is Freddie Miller. Freddie?
Wrestling, of course, coming up the 20th of December, Marietta, the Cobb Civic Center, a supercar that night. On the 27th, Columbus, Ohio, 7:30 tickets on sale now at the Ohio Center. On the 28th, Huntington, West Virginia. On the 29th, Springfield, Ohio, tickets on sale at Sears there. And tomorrow night, here's the Omni.
Tomorrow night, 8 o'clock, the Omni in Atlanta, the big one for the World's Heavyweight Championship. Nature Boy Ric Flair, champion against Wildfire Tommy Rich. Grudge match, the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, against the Great Kabuki. National Tag Team Championship. Brad and Bob Armstrong, champions against Kevin Sullivan and Wayne Ferris. Austin Idol against Michael Hayes. Terry Gordy against El Grand Apollo. Buzz Sawyer against Ray Candy. And a special attraction tag team event. Bad Bad Leroy Brown and Big Red against Superstar and Super D. It happens tomorrow night, 8 o'clock. A great card, the Omni in Atlanta.
Tommy Rich is with me, Tommy, tomorrow night. Self-discipline, self-control, those have to be the keys for you.
You know, that's exactly right, but you take a man like Ric Flair. Now, Flair knows I done beat him once. The World Heavyweight title, and that's what it's all about. That's the big one. Everybody's got a dream or a goal, and it's the World Heavyweight title. December the 13th, it's going to be just like the Georgia Bulldog. At home, they always win. Flair, the Omni, you better be ready because I'm going to give all these people an early Christmas present at the Omni. Thank you, Gordon.
Well, there's the bell now. We'll be seeing the Super Destroyer and the Superstar in action against Rick Thor and Pete Martin. The Superstar, of course, is the National Heavyweight Champion, the Super Destroyer. He and Superstar, as double tough a tag team combination as I've ever seen. Two very, very big, powerful men, yet move with amazing speed and agility.
Certainly, absolutely, Mr. Solon. You notice that he isn't getting fooled. He isn't getting fooled by quick tactics. Now, this man has got a problem here where he's fighting someone, I don't know, how many pounds would you say heavier? 70 pounds,
there's
maybe?
Probably a 50 to 70 pound weight differential,
pounds.
Yes.
And he has come upon it absolutely the wrong way. He couldn't trick that man. He tried to do some cute moves, but the man was just too powerful. Now, here's another monster right here. Look at that. Look at the power that he just whips that body over and immediately grinds down on something. That is tremendous. But Mr. Sully, what I was like, is that control or not?
That is indeed. Using that rear chin lock to its fullest extent, takes Thor back to the canvas once again. He's jarred him several times now. Tags up with a Super Destroyer. Super Destroyer using the knee very effectively that time. Thor in real trouble now. Would be Wine with him, I believe, to get over and tag up with Pete Martin, who is fresh, has not yet had a chance to get into the ring. Note the Super Destroyer and Superstar have already exchanged tags, and so they're keeping themselves fresh and at the same time keeping Thor trapped to their side of the ring.
Yes, absolutely. Mr. Sully, you're right on with what you're saying. That's exactly what they're doing. They're not allowing themselves to get hurt. But now what this young fella should have done, I wish I could tell them, but they just listen to me because I know what to do. They should go for the wheels. They should go for the pins right away, the legs, you see. Go for the legs. When you got a big man, you take him down with the legs and bring him down to your own size. But he didn't try to do that. He went out there and tried to go nose to nose. And in this particular, I could have done nose to nose with these people, but he couldn't. Well, he got tagged out. That's the smartest thing he's done here in this match.
Pete Martin tags in, drives a hard right hand three times to the midsection of the Super Destroyer with no effect whatsoever, at least no visible effect. And now the Super Destroyer begins to open up with his heavy artillery on Martin, a full body slam that drives Martin back to the canvas. The tag is made. The Superstar moves back in deliberately, then lashes out with a foot to the top of the head, catches him a thrust of the throat that has Martin back to the canvas again. Martin in the blue, in a lot of trouble now as the Superstar. And I would say that I have seen the Superstar and Super Destroyer in action many, many times, but today their methodology is cold and deliberate as I've ever seen it.
And that is called professional. That is called, they're out there, they're not playing games. They're out there to win and beat people and eat steak and drive Cadillacs, Jack. And that's just what they're doing. Did you notice how quick the fists were of the Mr. Superstar, the Super Destroyer? Did you notice the relentless punishment that he keeps giving? They're talking back and forth. You can hear them talking to their partners, saying, cheering each other on. This other team now hasn't got their stuff together. They're taking care of each other, and that's what you got to do in tag teams.
Well, obviously, of course, these two are the neck breaker by the Superstar. Inverted press to a lateral press. Did not allow the pin. Had his man, I believe, but did not allow the pin.
Vicious.
So it appears to me the Super Destroyer and Superstar now attempting to point up very graphically a lesson to anybody who might be watching exactly what they can expect when they step into that squared circle against them.
You're 100% right, Mr. Sully. That's just what they're doing. They know wrestlers watch. This is a national show, one of the best wrestling shows there is. They know how many wrestlers are watching out there to look at their opponents, and they're just letting them know, don't play no games with us, Jack, because we don't know how to play games. Nice tag there. He's not even tired there, that Super Destroyer. Here comes the Superstar. I admire this man a lot.
Both men with tremendous popular definition of confirmation. Both of them tipping those scales at around 270 pounds. As big and awesome a team as I have ever seen. I would have to liken their capabilities to that of the World Tag Team Champions, the Anderson Brothers. You could go down the list of great tag team combinations, but this lately, if you will, arrived tag team. Almost tore his head off that time. Martin delivered to the canvas once again. Super Destroyer off that crashes down across the midsection.
That man's out.
It is all over. It is certainly all over for Pete Martin. So Rick Thor out there cautiously getting ready to lend assistance as the Superstar and the Super Destroyer leave the ring area. Obviously, somewhat.
Hey, get the two fat men out here and help get that guy out of the ring.
Well, let me take a moment right now, if I may, to talk to two other great athletes in a great combination. To my right, from the south side of Chicago, Bad Bad Leroy Brown. To my left, Big Red. And I said, I think that says it all, gentlemen.
Hey, you said it all. We are the team. The masked men talk about what they're going to do. They are the team of the future. Well, you're looking at it, brother. Hey, 700 pounds. Sully, you know, I always wondered back in Chicago when a man had to wear a mask, something was wrong. And we're going to find out what's wrong with me and Big Red. Get him in the ring. Big Red, tell him about it, big fella.
And you know, I can tell him. You know, it's been a long time when people have come to these matches saying they need a team, somebody to straighten this mess up. And I know I got a man here, Gordon. I got a man from the south side of Chicago. Can do it like it's supposed to be did, you know?
Hey, so that, you know, we didn't come to talk. We're here for business, and me and Red been to get back, and we've been to go back. Whenever you come to see the Big Red and Big D, get ready, brother, because we're going to be fighting in action.
Good.
Good luck.
Well, you got it all from Bad, Bad Leroy Brown and Big Red. They're quite a combination indeed. And here are two fellows who will tip that 300-pound marker. Both of them as big and as powerful, I would have to say, as the Super Destroyer and the Superstar. No question about that. We've seen, I think, during the past hour, Rod, some outstanding competition. And I would say again that with the competition the way it is right here, right now, that any title could change hands.
Oh, absolutely. What you've got here is you've got a maze of the best athletes you got. Sometimes it's just the luck of the draw. Sometimes it's nothing but hard training. But, like, I can tell you exactly what it takes because I know what it takes, Mr. Soley, and so do you. It takes who can do it when they're down and out and hurting, who can do it the best. And that's just what we got here. Tommy Rich, he's going for world titles. We got national titles, national champions, more things than you can imagine, Mr. Soley. And it's been an exciting hour,
it has been indeed. May I just say, too, we've got more great action coming up in another hour of Georgia Championship Wrestling. So by all means, do stay tuned. We're going to take about 5 minutes out right now. Go to our good friend Bob Neal for the latest college scoreboard. He'll bring you up to date on what football is left and, of course, all of the basketball. So we'll be back in about 5 minutes. But right now, let's go to Bob Neal and the college scoreboard. And welcome to another hour of Georgia Championship Wrestling. During this next hour, we will be seeing the National Tag Team Champions in action. Also, the Universal Heartthrob as he bills himself Austin Idol. Buzz Sawyer will be in action a little bit later. Also, we'll be seeing Bad Bad Leroy Brown and Big Red and a host of others. Let me bring in Rod Piper right now, who's going to join me and lend his comments to the match.
Yes, and it's a pleasure to be here with you, Mr. Soley, as usual. I'm still continuing to get letters and lending my expertise, how much the fans appreciate. I'd like to say hello to my friends in Portland, greatest place in the world, and I'd like to say hello to you again, Mr. Soley. It's always a pleasure to be here with you.
Indeed, a pleasure to have Rod Piper with us. We're getting set for our first match now, and this should be an outstanding event. The National Tag Team Champions in action. Let's turn it over to our ring announcer.
Ladies and gentlemen, this tag team event, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. One fall, 10. Entering the ring now from Milano, Italy, at 241 pounds, here's Tony Russo. Tony Russo. His partner from Decatur, Georgia, at 265 pounds, meet Ed Timms. Ed Timms. Their opponents are the new national tag team champions from Marietta, Georgia, at a combined weight of 435 pounds, Bob and Brad Armstrong, the Armstrongs. Your referee is Nick Patrick.
Okay, Bob and Brad Armstrong, father and son tag team combination as the national tag team champions. Tony Russo moving out first against Brad Armstrong. And here's a young fellow who's got an outstanding future. Beautiful arm drag takedown to an inside arm bar. Notice the way Russo very quickly countered, moved back to his feet. Now trying to figure an escape, and from there, good hip toss. Hanging on like a pit bull was Brad Armstrong. A good tenacious hold. And once again, Russo gaining his feet.
Very nice, very nice. You know, Brad is one of the best young wrestlers I think that I have seen here. He's not afraid of anything. He digs right in there. Now, his father and I don't particularly get along because, well, that's just the way. I'm not going to get into that. It's not my job, is it? Brad is extremely good. Nice counter. Did you notice? Nice counter there. Grab the elbows. If he just could have got the elbows there, he would have had himself a pin. Just a little lack of experience. I could have got that pin there, but that's okay. Brad still is a super competitor.
Moves in against his man. Good block by Russo that time as Brad Armstrong tried for a variated hip toss, but it was Russo blocking it very nicely. Armstrong goes up now. Head scissors. Good counter by Russo, and there's where experience takes the measure so many times on youthful exuberance. He had him in a head scissors, but Russo was able to upend him.
You see, Russo is so powerful and so low to the ground. Oh, he got him. Shows him that man. is thinking. Young Brad there is thinking when he's doing it. He tried it. I didn't think he would try it again. And most wrestlers would say, once you miss something, they don't ever try it again because obviously the guy knows what you're going to do. Here is a case where, you see, that's wrong. Here's a case where Brad did it again and got away with it because it was unsuspected. Here comes Daddy. Oh, my favorite.
Two good hip tosses by Bob Armstrong into a lateral press. Armstrong back on his feet very quickly. Tag is made. Ed Timms moves in. Ed Timms and Ken Timms, brother tag team combination. This time, though, it is Ed Timms out on his own. Timms complaining to the referee, Nick Patrick, about the closed fist. Armstrong is not the kind to deviate from the rules unless, well, something happens that he feels forced into it. Once again, the tag is made, and Brad Armstrong moves in.
And it shows you, though, you see, Mr. Armstrong, Daddy, he was standing on the turnbuckle. Now, that's just the difference between me and that man in the blue tights. When he stood on the turnbuckle and threatened to hit him, I would have backed away just like that man did, and as soon as, did you notice Armstrong said, oh, well, he's backed away, boom, I would have attacked right there. Little science, a little thinking, you see, Mr. Armstrong. Armstrong, I know you also think, but, you know, what did he say? Something about he wrote the book on wrestling, and I wrote the revised edition. Nice teamwork here, though. Nice teamwork. You can't give them, you can't deny them that they're the great tag team that they are.
They are indeed the national tag team champions, and up to a top armbar now by Bob Armstrong, keeping total pressure now on Timms. And Timms, I'm sure, is thinking about getting over, tagging up with Russo if he can. Good combination of experience here now with and Timms catching him.
Not good. But that man's not doing what Timms isn't doing. His feet weren't positioned right to put his body into the blow. That was the difference. Consequently, it didn't even phase Armstrong.
It didn't indeed. Once again, the tag is made, and Brad Armstrong moves back into the ring.
Yeah, young Brad here really shows the guts that he's got as far as it takes guts to be able to get in there when you got a man that's maybe, I don't know, what would you say, 100 pounds, possibly 70 pounds, maybe heavier. Not, it takes guts to go for a move. There's some moves, if you go for them and you miss them, you're in trouble. Well, this man still goes for the moves. He still goes for them double legs. He's not worried about missing it. He's got that confidence, and that's what it takes. That's why I'm such a great champion. It's confidence, Mr. Soldier. Of course, you know that.
And Brad Armstrong continues to hold the aggressor here. Now the tag is made, and Tony Russo moves in. Timms keeping Brad Armstrong tied up as Russo gets in a cheap shot across the back. Pitcher coming off ropes, drove that boot to the midsection of Brad Armstrong.
What a kick.
And now snapmare that carries Brad to the mat once again. And Russo now beginning to press that advantage.
Absolutely. Now, Russo is no one to play with. He's a man, now I know him, he's a man that will play possum. He'll let you hit him, and he'll back off and hold himself, and he'll think, well, I got him fixed, I got him done, I'll get in there and finish him off, and boom, he'll explode just like he's done with this young fellow. Now we're going to find out if this guy really can withstand pain and pressure and still think. I wonder what Daddy's thinking right now.
Well, series of forearms into the small of the back, and Armstrong fires back, catches him again. Good forearm that rocks Timms that time. Timms rocked again and driven to the canvas by Brad Armstrong. Armstrong trying to get it together, caught by Tony Russo from behind. And now Bob Armstrong exploding on Ed Timms.
Armstrong is fast.
No question about that. And now all four of them in the ring, and we've got a Pier Sixer rolling here now.
Now, if they can just get their stuff together, the referee's counting. There shows there's experience there. And a three.
Got the three count. Got the three count. And so the winning combination of Bob and Brad Armstrong, the national tag team champions. To come into the ring, Ron Bass is one of the competitors. I want to have a word with Ron Bass before he goes out into the ring. It's been a long time since he's been here in Georgia.
You know, Gordon, I've been around the country now for a while, and I did things kind of a different way than what I'm used to. I tried to bring a little law and order to some people around here, but you know, it wasn't appreciated. People didn't appreciate the big outlaw for the things he was doing. The promoters didn't appreciate it. The people didn't appreciate it. So I'm going to tell you something right now, people. No more will you ask any quarter from the Bass Man when he give it to you. From now on, I'm going to go out there, and I'm going to show you what I'm made of, son. I'm going to beat anybody that gets into the ring with me, friend, because I'm 290 pounds, I'm 6'3", and I know what I'm doing in that ring, and I can either wrestle you or I can fight you, whatever I have to do, brother. And let me tell you something. Before I've done in the Georgia area or all over the world for that matter, you're going to know my name and people's going to say, Bass, you're the best it's ever been, friend.
Well, some highly confident comments from one Ron Bass, but knowing his reputation, having seen him in action many, many times in the past, he is a tough, durable, and dangerous opponent. Let's move to the ring now, and let's get this match underway. One fall with a 10-minute time limit. It is Bass removing his chaps now and his jacket, and he's moving out against Rick Benfield. Benfield is a tried and proven athlete here on Georgia Championship Wrestling. So Mr. Bass is finding himself some very, very tough competition in his first appearance here on Georgia Championship Wrestling.
Yes, you know, Mr. Ron Bass has what he, you, this man here has tremendous, tremendous strength in his shoulders. He used to be a power lifter. I just happen to know something about this gentleman, Mr. Soler, if you don't mind for a second. He used to be a power lifter, and I have seen him military press 400 pounds just from his shoulders. So what he's done is he's adapted his wrestling style so it mostly using shoulders, which is just sensible, right? If a man's got a strong arms, he gets holds, it takes arms to hold. Strong shoulders, he gets holds that he can use the leverage on the shoulders. Now, you notice here, that's kind of what he's doing right now because his shoulders are so powerful. Big man.
It was interesting to note, though, that he was feinting his opponent out of it at the very, very beginning, at the onset of the match, because he scissored the one arm with his legs and apparently giving Benfield the impression that he was going to be, if you will, a bottom wrestler working with the legs primarily, now has gone to the top of the body.
You ought to be wrestling yourself, Mr. Soley, because that is ingenious. Only people with tremendous experience would realize something, and that's exactly what that man was doing. And I'm not teasing you now at all, because there's so much science that people don't understand what's going on there. That's just what he was doing, and you confuse your opponent. Now, that, well, that's right. I don't even need to say anymore. That's exactly right.
Bass continues to punish his man now. Drove that knee into the biceps and triceps of one Rick Benfield. And Benfield, who I'm sure had heard of Bass's reputation before stepping into the ring, had to know what kind of an opponent he was facing. However, Bass, who has claimed to be a staunch supporter of law and order in the ring in the past, said that is no longer the case, that now he intends to defeat his opponents in any way possible. Chicken wing into a hammerlock now, and Mr. Benfield has his hands full.
Absolutely, you know. And one thing, the problem with a lot of fighters is they get psyched out before they even go in here. Now, Mr. Benfield might have taken a look. He comes here, and a lot of times on this television show, the matches, they just sign open contracts, and you fight whoever they say. That takes a lot of guts to do that. And now, when they find out, they get here, and they say, I got to fight Ron Bass, 280 pounds. They think about it, and they get scared. Like, look at that knee driving in there. They get scared, and they get psyched out, and they're beat before they even get in there. Of course, now, I've never been scared of nothing in my life, and that's the difference between fighters. But it can happen to anybody, and maybe this just psych this man out a little bit, I think.
Benfield trying to use those ring ropes to force a break, and the referee double-checking as Bass hooked the arm, brought it back. Now Bass drives the knee in once again, and Benfield, in a lot of pain, slowly coming back to his feet. Bass hurdles him into that turnbuckle, again punishing the left arm in the upper area of the shoulder around the deltoids. Again, smashes Benfield into the opposite turnbuckle, and so Bass is a totally dominant figure in the ring at this time.
Absolutely. You see, he's just he's completely controlling this man. Looks to me like what he's doing, he's just getting himself a bit of a workout. He's got the man. I think he can beat him at any particular time. Now, that's my own opinion. Now, one bad thing about that, though, and I've done it before myself, but I have not made the mistake. If you go get overconfident like that and get a man beaten on, he may be playing possum. It's possible to make a mistake there. But in this particular case, I'm quite sure he has him completely under control.
Two of the most dangerous things in professional sports, of course, overconfidence in yourself and underestimating the power of your opponent. And Mr. Bass would be well served to keep that thought in mind, as you pointed up.
Yes, sir. Yeah. But the power that he has, along with the weight he has, weight and power do go together in a sense. He's just got control. But notice now how he's just rubbing the face of the man. Yeah? He hasn't even attempted a pin yet, and he's smart enough to know. And if he wanted to beat this man right now, I believe he could, but he hasn't even attempted it. Oh, this man, the man's giving it an effort. You see, that's one thing about championship wrestling. You've got nobody out there that doesn't have guts, boy, that isn't trying 100%.
No question about that. And Benfield tried just a moment. He momentarily, and a look of somewhat surprise came over Bass's face. And now Bass settling right down, and no longer is he toying with his man. Now he's beginning to push him into the power slam.
Made his mind up.
Yep, he did indeed. Caught him, and there you see a smiling, victorious Ron Bass. We might take a look at that power slam once again. You could hear Bass saying, "I told you, Soli," and he is indeed a very powerful figure of a man. Notice the way he crouches his man, hooks him on one shoulder, brings him up. Then a forward momentum drives down across his chest into a full power slam and scores the pinfall. So, again, a very, very fine victory for Ron Bass, making his first appearance in a long time here on Georgia Championship Wrestling. Well, of course, great action will take place tomorrow night at the Omni here in Atlanta. We hope all of you make your plans to attend. And, of course, tonight in Chattanooga, something interesting.
Let me say something. Bob Armstrong, you are out here getting in my personal business. No one messes with me and Kabuki. So tonight in Chattanooga, I will be there. You be there. And Dusty Rhodes, tomorrow night, Atlanta, Georgia, the Omni, I'm going to get you again. But this time, brother, you ain't walking, because we're going to knock you down and keep you down.
Well, there you have it, tomorrow night at the Omni. And now, for wrestling around other parts of the country, here's our good friend Freddie Miller.
Thank you, Gordon. Tonight in Chattanooga, 8:30 Memorial Auditorium. Monday night, Augusta Bell Auditorium, 8 o'clock. Next Thursday night, Gainesville, Georgia. That's Thursday, Georgia Mountain Center at 8. Next Friday night, Gadsden, Alabama. The Coliseum starts at 8. On Sunday, December 20th, Marietta, the Cobb Civic Center, a supercard. What about tomorrow night?
Tomorrow night, 8 o'clock, the Omni in Atlanta, the big one for the World's Heavyweight Championship. Nature Boy Ric Flair, champion, against Wildfire Tommy Rich. Grudge match, the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, against the Great Kabuki. National Tag Team Championship, Brad and Bob Armstrong, champions, against Kevin Sullivan and Wayne Ferris. Austin Idol against Michael Hayes. Terry Gordy against El Grand Apollo. Buzz Sawyer against Ray Candy. And a special attraction tag team event. Bad Bad Leroy Brown and Big Red against Superstar and Super D. It happens tomorrow night, 8 o'clock. A great card, the Omni in Atlanta.
It's going to be a great night. And tickets, of course, are available at all seats locations at the Omni itself. And, Brad, a very exciting night for you and your dad.
Exactly right. You know, we fought long and hard for that national tag team title, and we got that trophy at the house right now. We're going to bring it down there tomorrow night and hopefully hang on to it.
Well, you got trouble starting tonight.
Well, I'll tell you something. I heard Gary Hart talking about me jumping into his personal business. You bring that boogeyman to Chattanooga night, and I'll jump into more than your personal business, mister. I'll start softening him up for Dusty tomorrow night, because when you get there tomorrow night, the Dream will be waiting on you, brother, and I'll see that he has a pair of bloused eyes and a big old popped-out nose for him tomorrow night. And let me tell you something, Sullivan and Ferris. You've been out here running your mouth about, I'm an old man and this young man don't know where to go. We know where to go. We come into the Omni tomorrow night, bringing that four-foot trophy, putting it by the ring, and you come and take it home if you're big enough and bad enough.
Austin Idol moving into the ring now, going up against Vinny Valentino. One fall with a 10-minute time limit. Referee is Nick Patrick. And again, Idol moves out into the ring and very quickly starts issuing edicts, obviously, to the referee, Nick Patrick. And Idol, again, beginning to take off that...
Yes, he is truly a master of psychology here, a master of confusing his opponent, and it is an art in what he's doing. Just take a look at that fella. He's not really sure just what to make of him, you know?
Well, you got a point there, and of course, this sport, being the way it is necessarily somewhat narcissistic. Here you have two great men who are obviously in tremendous condition.
Yes, absolutely in tremendous condition. But the thing of it is if you can get that other man just confused just a little bit. Now, I'm not talking about he doesn't know whether he's on page 28 or 49 or you forgot what book he read. I mean confused for a split second. That's all you need to take, get a leg guy to get that man down on the mat and to get an advantage. And I think myself that that is a tremendous psychology because I adapted it and I am the one who started that kind of psychology. So that's good. Why I know about it.
Good single leg pickup, but it was a good block by Valentino. And Austin Idol quickly seizing advantage of having his man tied up in the ropes, punishing those quadricep femoris muscles. And now again, single leg pickup into a double leg back trip. And Vinny Valentino back to the canvas. And notice the way he's trying to go for a single leg Boston crab. Trying to get...
Yes, very good Boston crab. Very good, and he's got the knee in there to ensure the pressure. That's where you want the pressures on the knee. Oh, he took it out. I would have stayed with that hold because he had advantage there for sure.
Right on the back to the right hand to the side of the jaw of Vinny Valentino. And it is idle now, driving a boot to the midsection, has Valentino. Valentino fires to the midsection now, and it is idle, getting a side headlock and drives.
This idle is definitely a go-getter. He's not afraid. He knows when he's got someone hurt. That's instinct. That's instinct that comes from animals. When they have the knowledge that the man is hurt, they go after him. There's vicious. Yes, it is vicious. It's brutal. Yes, it is brutal, but it is necessary in the sport of professional wrestling. That's what makes it such a fantastic sport.
Idle back on his feet, and Valentino catches him. One to the midsection coming in. Idle brings him up into a backbreaker, then dumps him back to the can. And he's got the lumbar region of the back in trouble now on Valentino. Valentino having trouble getting enough power in those legs to get him back to his feet. And look at Idle setting him up as Valentino trying to get to his feet. Idle drives the knee into the side of the rib cage once again.
Yeah, got him down, got him hurt. The guy is scrambling. The thing to do now, you're wasting your time, son, crawling on the mat, trying to get away from him. The thing for you to do now, you can take some blows on the back, is to get your waist lock on him from the front, get your opponent close to you. That way he can hit you. That's why you're such a fantastic commentator, Mr. Soley, is because you can spot these things.
And it is Valentino caught in the back, and drove it right into the coccyx area that time, and now he has Valentino in trouble once again, brings him up another.
Very nice.
Another atomic knee drop, and he is really concentrated on, he's concentrating on jamming that spine and catching those vertebrae.
Absolutely. And we were just talking about psychology, and I just told you that I'm the one who started. And he says, look at that Piper. That's an athlete. You see, what he's doing is trying to impress me. Because obviously he's talking to me because he wants to impress me. But Mr. Idle, you're fantastic, but you're not Roddy Piper.
And Valentino trying to get up, and once again, Idle catches him. A lot of punishment into the hip area, into the lumbar region of the back, now up to the thoracic area, and he continues to punish this man. It's been an almost completely spinal attack.
Yes, he's concentrated on the lower spine. If you can get a disc moved in there, if you can get a pinched nerve, if you can just make it numb, what he's doing is the bottom of the spine controls the legs. Another way of immobilizing the legs. If a man can't move, boy, you're going to have a tough time fighting. Now's the time to stay. Grab that leg there. Grab that leg. You see, he's not thinking in action. That's what you must do. Austin has definitely got him. Yeah. Now he's having a little fun, I guess. Boy, I wish you'd do that to me. Yeah.
Narcissism at its height here with and beautiful move by Vinny Valentino into a backslide.
Three.
Almost had him.
I thought it was a three.
Valentino caught him that time, a headbutt right at the bell line, and Valentino explodes on Austin Idle once again, and Idle in trouble. Valentino catches him again, another good forearm. Valentino now with an elbow to the back of the head. It's Valentino bringing him up for a full body slam. Austin Idle in trouble now as Valentino gets up on that second rope. Idle drove those knees into the midsection of Vinny Valentino. Going for the Vegas leg lock.
He's got it. Go for the rope, son.
And he's got it, the Vegas leg lock. And so expertly applied by one Austin Idle. Idle was in trouble, no question about that. He was in trouble. But there again, you see the tremendous capabilities of this man. He got himself, found himself, and look at this Valentino. He's game. He wants to keep right on going. And wait a minute, Idle going back, trying to put the Vegas leg lock on him once again, and the referee warning him as Idle punishing Valentino now. And we may have a reversal here. No, sir. Michael Hayes charges the ring. Michael Hayes exploding on Austin Idle. And I was, it's a strange thing. From behind, there's Terry Gordy. Terry Gordy exploding, and Michael Hayes out there against two men now. And wait a minute. Here comes Bob Armstrong.
Hayes after Gordy, and we've got Austin Idol, Terry Gordy. Michael Hayes, another swinging soul. Terry Gordy and Austin Idol leaving the ring as Michael Hayes and Bob Armstrong challenging both of them to move back into the ring.
Just look at that shirt, Sully. Look at that shirt. Nobody embarrasses me like that. Especially Bob Armstrong, a disgrace to the South, because, boy, you're not from the South. There's no sense of you going around and telling a big lie like you do.
Thank you very much. Enough is enough here. Michael Hayes and Bob Armstrong still challenging Austin Idol and Terry Gordy to move back into the ring, and we're getting order restored here as quickly as we can. Armstrong and Hayes now leaving the ring, and I would like to ask Mr. Gordy and Mr. Idol, gentlemen, if I may please leave the area. I would like to take a couple of moments right now to talk to the NWA World Heavyweight Champion, Ric Flair.
You know, it must be refreshing for you to have me out on this fabulous TV program after seeing all this nonsense. You know, you think the world champion being here in town alone would straighten out all these guys. Everybody, as you know, wants to be where I am. Tommy Rich, Roddy Piper, Ole Anderson, Michael Hayes, the list is endless, wrestling too. They all want to be where I am, Gordon Solie. But there's only one man wearing the custom-made clothes, the $100 silk shirts, the $50 silk ties, the $250 lizard shoes, and walking around with a $17,000 gold belt, me. Now, isn't that something? With all these guys doing all this to attract attention, all I have to do is walk out here, myself, and all my magnificence, and stand here and let the people out there see what a real class wrestler looks like. And then forget about everything else. Now, what were you going to say, sir?
Well, as a matter of fact, I think you've said it all and said rather well. We're referring, of course, to a gentleman who is hopefully destined
where,
to be...
Where is Roddy Piper, by the way? I just saw him out here a minute ago. And I heard Piper make a statement about Austin Idol not being Roddy Piper. Well, Piper is a real dude, and I hear him out here week after week. And Piper, come here for a moment. You are really a top-flight addition. I heard you mention Austin Idol was a great wrestler, but he wasn't Roddy Piper. Well, Ric Flair is a great wrestler, and he's the world champion. Think about that, brother.
All right, so. Well, thank you, and, well, we'll be back. One fall, 10-minute time limit now as Buzz Sawyer moves out against Keith Larson. And there's Sawyer with that tremendous power that he has. I was talking to young Brad Wolf about Buzz Sawyer the other day. Brad is an aficionado of wrestling, and we both agreed that Sawyer is as powerful a competitor as we've seen in a long, long time. And Mr. Larson is finding that out very quickly. Larson in the red trunks. It is Sawyer in the blue trunks. Sawyer began his career in the... Wow, look at this again, the tremendous power of Sawyer. Sawyer has it everywhere, too. He's got the great power in the legs. Tremendous femoris. Larson coming off the rope. Caught Sawyer and dropped him. Beautiful drop kick, and Sawyer outside the ring. A totally embarrassed individual. He's brash, he's cocky, and he was caught completely off guard. There was a situation of total overconfidence, and the very thing that I was talking about a little earlier, the two greatest mistakes, overconfidence in yourself and underestimating your opponent. And now Sawyer taking out his embarrassment, his humiliation, by complaining to the referee, Nick Patrick. And may I point out something about Nick Patrick? You don't want to complain too much to that man. Larson ducks away once again. And so Sawyer is becoming a picture now of frustration as Larson ducks away and moves from side to side.
Now they're collar and elbow. Sawyer pulls him back to the ropes. And good block by Larson, and he delivers a forearm to the side of the jaw of Buzz Sawyer. And it is Sawyer who drove in that time. Good feint. He feinted to the shoulders. Looked like he was going in collar and elbow and then drove a knee to the midsection. And Rod, the thing we were talking about earlier, somebody being over. Ooh. Larson hurtled out to the concrete. And Sawyer right out after him.
Boy, you see the viciousness in this man? This man is out to win now. That is fantastic. That's what I like to see in a wrestler. Look at him. He's not going to give that man a chance. Look at, and he's watching the count. Notice Mr. Sawyer now. What he's doing is he's making sure that he doesn't go beyond the jurisdiction of the referee, not getting disqualified. That's what you got to do. You got rules in professional wrestling, of course. But the thing, if you can stretch him, if you can stay within him, why not?
Well, he stays on the borderline, no question about that. And those tactics have driven him to a point now of having possibly some superiority or dominance in this particular match. Larson charging back in again. The count was broken momentarily. And Larson catches it to the side of the head. Now it is Sawyer bringing him down a front chin lock and brought him forward to the mat.
Yes, nice front face lock. Of course, people yelling choke, but it's not a choke. It's just a nice front face lock. Oh, now, what he's doing there, did you see him kind of grab a little hair and knock it back and forth? That's not so much to keep the hold intact as it is just to get him hot and get that guy going to finally say, I want to get out of here. Now, that's to hurt him. Oh, he's going to make a mistake if he gets on the referee.
And Sawyer, completely frustrated man, caught again by Larson twice. And Sawyer now pulling out all stops. Completely pulling out all stops as I have to believe in a sense that Sawyer must be getting just a little bit desperate.
Beautiful, beautiful. Hey, he's not worried about nothing. He knows he's got him under control. He's taking his time. All the qualifications of greatness.
Variation of a hip lock takedown now with a side headlock, and you see Mr. Sawyer now framed in controlled rage as he dominates the situation with Keith Larson.
Yes. Keith Larson is definitely in a little trouble here, and he's a game competitor. What sometimes what the people don't realize is when they see someone like Buzz Sawyer going in there and throwing this man around like that, they say, oh, well, yeah, he beat that guy, but what, you know, who did he beat? See, now that man laying down on the floor there could just maim and tame you. But now, it just shows the superiority that Buzz Sawyer got. That's not any common man he's throwing around down there. So it shows you the power that this man has.
Larson out of good Scandinavian background, I would assume, and a good high vertical suplex by Buzz Sawyer, bringing Larson back into the ring, and that has thoroughly stunned Keith Larson. Sawyer brings him up, not satisfied, not even try for a pinning combination. Uses a backbreaker, brings him up. Now, it's better than 200 and some odd pounds. He slammed it like a sack of potatoes down on the canvas. Now, into a variation of the Russian sickle.
Beautiful.
Does muscles, spinae erecti muscles being strained in the wrong direction, and it is Buzz Sawyer victorious over Keith Larson using a variation of that Russian sickle. I want to call Buzz Sawyer over here for just a moment because obviously there was a point in that match when he was very, very definitely in trouble, in my opinion. And I want to ask him about that because here is a man who I've said many, many times is a brash and very, very cocky individual, but has a habit of backing it up with victories in the squared circle. Would you admit, however, that there was a point you were in trouble?
Never! I'm never in trouble, Mr. Soley. Strategy's what it's all about. That man thought he had me, but you've seen who came out on top. Everywhere I go and every place I've been, just like Mr. Roddy Piper said, vicious, Daddy, get vicious. And that exactly is what I'm going to do every time I'm in the ring. Mr. Soley, you haven't seen one thing yet. I'm just now starting. The Georgia Championship Wrestling should be embarrassed to put that man in the ring with me. Do you understand that? Embarrassed! Because you've seen
Just like he's seen.
Everyone out there seen who won and who's the best.
And you're looking at me.
Nothing more to say about that, except we'll be right back. Okay. He just... Bad Leroy Brown was nice enough to say, excuse me, there are times when I stand between these two, I feel that I'm between two of the most powerful men in professional wrestling, and, well, fellas like the Superstar and the Super Destroyer have found out a little of that, too.
Hey, Sully, hey, we come out here to show the film, and we want to see the film, and we want the people to see
what me and Big Red going to do from here on in, because I am the policeman.
Roll it, roll it, roll it!
What they're referring to, of course, is an incident that occurred here last week on Georgia Championship Wrestling. Saved him that time. Russell in trouble again. Brought him up. Has him up on that... up on the turnbuckle. The superplex. The superplex. Executed by the Super Destroyer. So the Super Destroyer and the Superstar are victorious over Mr. Valentino and Mr. Russell.
Let me ask you a few questions, Gordon. Where does this big goof, this overgrown howdy doody in that outfit, come out here and try to break up some kind of fabrications, try to develop some kind of false pictures proving that I won that gold illegally? Now, come on in here. Gumbo.
You can have a thousand pictures, baby, but I got Legos and Bruce right here again.
Hey, listen.
You can keep that up. It don't matter with me.
Matter to you.
Hey. Wait a minute. Wait a second. Wait a minute. Big Red exploding on the Superstar and the Super Destroyer, and Big Red has charged the ring. Big Red in there, and he's piercing it with both of them right now. And we have got to get some kind of order restored, but Big Red handling himself beautifully now. He's against the two men, the Super Destroyer and the Superstar. And Bad Leroy Brown. Bad Leroy Brown from the south side of Chicago just hit the scene. And you talk about bedlam and mayhem. We've got it going now. The Superstar and the Super Destroyer facing Big Red and Bad Leroy Brown. And they are beating a hasty retreat. We'll be back. We'll be back. In...
Well, we're back here right now. We saw what happened last week.
And look here, we'll be back, and we got a surprise for the people today.
Okay, there you have it. Bad Leroy Brown and Big Red. And I'll tell you what, when they come out here, they can do anything they want. All right, let's turn to the ring now. We've got an outstanding match coming up, El Gran Apollo. And it is Apollo moving up against Timms, and Apollo in the red trunks from Havana, Cuba. Apollo has been an all-around athlete all of his life, competed in a number of different sports, soccer for one, obviously amateur wrestling, began his pro career. And so it is now Ken Timms moves up, gets the side headlock, and Apollo slips away from that. Beautiful heel block and takedown by Apollo from the hammerlock. As I said, Apollo, of course, his amateur career and all in Havana, Cuba, then migrated to Puerto Rico, where he began his professional wrestling career. From then, came on into the United States proper, and has certainly made some tremendous inroads. Here's a man who's a fine physical specimen as well, Rod.
Absolutely, and you know, when you say that myself, I did not grow up eating steaks and with automatic garage doors. When you're talking about this guy with Havana, Cuba, it means something when a man grows up and knows what it's like to eat out of garbage cans and fight. It puts something inside him that you can't buy, that you can't make up yourself. And this man has got that inside him. He's got that thing where I gotta eat. And he's probably now he doesn't need to be quite so aggressive. But when you have that inside you, that's called just that fight. And that's what's important. That's why I'm so good. And that's why this gentleman here is so aggressive and such scientific and great physical condition.
certainly no question about that. Tim's now beginning to find out that he's gotten himself into a Cuban hurricane here.
Yes.
Apollo off the bottom. Beautiful shoulder smash. Drops him back to the canvas once again. Apollo up and over his man. And Tim's tried to move through him, and Apollo very quickly
Beautiful.
Hooked him into a backslide. No,
Beautiful.
Sir. Tim's rolled out of it.
Good thinking there on the part of Santino. Is that the gentleman's name?
El Grand Apollo.
El Grand Apollo, pardon me. Good thinking. I don't know the names, but I know what they can do. And I don't. That's it. And good thinking on his part. Nice goes for a nice pick. He knows he needs to win. He's not interested in punishing. He's interested in winning. And after all, that's all there is.
Tim's now driving a knee up high in the back of El Grand Apollo. Apollo slips away from that. Goes from an arm drag into a chicken wing hammerlock. And look at Tim's, however, countering.
Oh.
Apollo hangs on. And so Tim's once again had started an aggressive move, but it was Apollo blocking. And now Tim's utilizing the ring ropes, forcing the break.
Very
and
good.
Again, a good clean break by Apollo.
Very good, very good. That's right, a hurricane. And Tim's there saying, who can wrestle in weather like this, man? This fella is coming on strong. He's completely confused, Tim's. And don't get me wrong now, Tim's is not somebody that's easily confused. He's a big, strong fella, and he's not too afraid of anything.
That's a 10-4 on that one. A good reversal there by El Grand Apollo. Nick Patrick watching carefully as Tim's again utilizing the ring ropes to force the break. And so many wrestlers, when they find themselves coming up just a little bit short, will get themselves into those ring ropes and force the break, which gives them another opportunity to move out.
You know, they learn that from the beginning, even amateur. When you're an amateur and you're in trouble, you hear your coach yelling, watch where you are, watch where you are. Meaning, if you just slip off that mat a little bit, after all, it's science. That's what I've adapted in wrestling. It's science. It's not the barroom brawl. Very good one.
Tim's out from a vertical souplet, and so Tim's proving to be a very durable. To an inside cradle and hooks the far leg.
Good official. Good official. You see, he just knocked down there and jumping down and counting one before he looks. He's looking and checking. Fantastic. Very professional.
Tim's drives a boot to the midsection and a knee to the side of the head of El Grand Apollo. And breaker on Apollo, and Tim's may have an upset in the making here as he goes into the lateral press, but it is Apollo powering out. And so Apollo has found that, and he launches out with a hard right hand to the midsection, one to the side of the jaw that staggers Tim's down, elbow to the back of the head. And so,
very good.
Tim's.
Did you notice? I'm sorry, Mr. Sully. Did you notice when Tim's was going to execute that move he did a few seconds ago, Apollo slapped him on the leg one time. What that was is he was hoping that Tim's would think that there was a counter and let go of the hold for a second. Unfortunately, Tim's was smart enough, or unfortunately for Apollo, Tim's was smart enough not to do that.
And again, we're getting back as we were talking earlier. This is human chess, and in chess, of course, the mental gymnastics are certainly just as important as any physical action that you take in the ring.
Yes, sir. And, sir, Mr. Stoley, have you ever seen finer competition or a finer wrestling program than this right here? Of course, that's a... Well, how can you answer that? Of course you haven't. Yes, and I haven't either, and I can answer it honestly. You might be a little biased, which I doubt, but I can honestly answer. Look, knees! I love it.
Apollo now unleashing some heavy artillery on Tim's and now drives him into that turnbuckle, and Apollo very quickly hooks those legs, had him in a partial stun position. Tim's able to power out once again using the most powerful muscles of the body, the muscles in the legs, hooks him in the salto, well-executed salto by El Grand Apollo, now into a lateral press. No, sir, into the ropes. And again, Tim's using those ropes. This is the third or the fourth time that Tim's has utilized the ring ropes to force the break.
Yeah, Tim's hurt. Tim's hurt now. You see, that's where it takes a fighter to be a champion, is when instead of sitting back like Tim's, nice drop kick there, like Tim's did, he should have been diving in there and been aggressive, man. You got to get hurt. You got to understand pain. Nice move.
Well executed cross body block that... put him back to the canvas and out of action. And El Grand Apollo from Havana, Cuba. And we might get a chance to look at that once again. Now watch Apollo as he moves up on that top ring rope. And I might point out now he's using the entire body, not the elbow or a knee, but the entire body. And the upper thigh catches Tim's across the side of the jaw. That gives him all the time he needs for that quick, stunning blow on the count of three. And it is all over. That is for sure. Well, I'll tell you what, it may be all over tomorrow night at the Omni here in Atlanta as Big Red and Bad Leroy
Man,
Brown.
Sully, you said enough! Tomorrow night, the Omni, destroyer. Hey, superstar, get ready. The Soul Patrol gonna be on call. And when, like I said, when Rick Red called me, when the Soul Patrol be in action, brother, we don't take no for an answer. Show them what a friend.
Hey, look here, you know they always got a bad habit of tearing things up. You know, every week they tear something up. So we got something we want to tear. You know, faces of them two clowns right here. They got the only tomorrow night. Tomorrow night, the 13th, baby. You gonna get what's coming to you. I'm telling you the truth, boy.
Yeah, they may eat him up tomorrow night. And for wrestling around the country, here's Freddie Miller.
Thank you, Gordon. The 20th of December, Marietta's Cobb Civic Center. Sunday the 27th in Columbus, Ohio, 7:30. The tickets now on sale at the center in all five major Columbus Lazarus stores. The 28th, Huntington, West Virginia. The 29th, Springfield, Ohio. And what about the big one right here in Atlanta?
Tomorrow night, 8 o'clock, the Omni in Atlanta, the big one for the World's Heavyweight Championship. Nature Boy Ric Flair, champion, against Wildfire Tommy Rich. Grudge match, the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, against the Great Kabuki. National Tag Team Championship, Brad and Bob Armstrong, champions, against Kevin Sullivan and Wayne Ferris. Austin Idol against Michael Hayes. Terry Gordy against El Grand Apollo. Buzz Sawyer against Ray Candy. And a special attraction tag team event. Bad Bad Leroy Brown and Big Red against Superstar and Super D. It happens tomorrow night, 8 o'clock. A great card, the Omni in Atlanta.
There you have it, the music of the Mitchell Freeburg. Michael Hayes, and Michael Hayes goes up against Austin Idol tomorrow night at the Omni.
You know something, Austin Idol's out here blabbing and talking about this. He made two mistakes. Number one, you said Michael Hayes thinks he's sexy and thinks he's pretty. I know it. But see, that ain't got nothing to do with when you get in that square circle, boy. See, I laid low. Everybody say, where's Michael Hayes? What's he doing? I just showed you what I'm going to do. And now tomorrow night, the Doctor of Viciousness is going to scream, shout, I'm going to... Because it's you and it's me by ourselves.
Superstar and the Super Destroyer in action next.
Normally I've come out here, I'm completely controlled, but these two high-calorie garbage eaters, you know who I'm talking about, they can come out here and stuff their big ugly mouths with that cake or cookie and think it's going to be a picnic. I want them to watch, because if they've got any guts, they'll come out here.
An open challenge here from, obviously, a gentleman who is beginning to lose some self-control. I'm referring, of course, to the Superstar. We're going to see them in action right now, going up against Tom Rogers and Bruce Gallagher. And I'll say one thing. Rogers has the fine skill and capabilities of quite a wrestler. Gallagher has that, but Gallagher has another added facet, too. Gallagher will street brawl with you right now. He'll go up here. Wow!
Oh, what a move!
Rogers caught him. Beautiful crossbody, but look at the power of the Superstar.
No kidding. What a move on this part. This is such a fine young athlete there, because he knows he's outweighed and he's going to try to trick him. It's like the matador and the bull. That's just what you're doing here. Don't get yourself in a corner, young fella. Such a good wrestler getting confused and beaten. That's how so many good professional wrestlers...
You hear the Superstar shouting from ringside. He is still totally and completely irate over the comments and the actions of Big Red and Bad Bad Leroy Brown. But they're two wrong fellows.
Show them how much, if they want to stuff their mouth with cake, get them out here now!
Sure. You got him a little upset here, huh?
He's gone off the deep end on this one. Gallagher dragged into the ring by the Super Destroyer. And the Super Destroyer driving with the knees and now with feet on Bruce Gallagher. And Gallagher really never had a chance. I know his capabilities. I know just how rugged he can be. But he has not had a chance to get moving.
Now, as he referred to them, those fat guys, now, I'm not so sure they're fat. They're big, powerful men, and they moved those two gentlemen that Superstar was talking about. And it's going to be interesting. Instead of fighting two guys that are 30, 40 pounds lighter than you, these guys are going to be the small ones in that ring. And it's going to be a very interesting competition. Now, he may be talking more than he can handle yet. Another thing, though, of course, about them, they brought out that nice big cake. If it was me and I had a fight coming up soon, I would be bringing out vitamin pills, boys. Not cakes. Cakes for kids.
You hear him? Super Destroyer, yeah. There's a tremendous amount of personal anger involved here now with the superstar and super destroyer against. And again, you could hear them referring back to the physical attributes of both Big Red and Bad Leroy Brown.
Yeah, and Bad certainly is not a fat boy. He's a big, powerful man. Big Red is big and powerful, and with power comes strength. First thing they got to figure is how are they going to get them guys off their feet if they ever fight him?
Gallagher caught as he was doubled up on by the Super Destroyer and the Superstar. And once again, the tag is made, and Gallagher in a lot of trouble there. As I said, of course, he was never able to press that accelerator down and get moving. There's the neck breaker.
Oh, fantastic. But this is fantastic, too. Two great teams. Oof.
Count of three, the Super Destroyer and the Superstar victorious over Bruce Gallagher and Tom Rogers. And two totally out.
Get a cookie, stuff it down your mouth.
Where are the two fat boys?
Well, they're not boys, they're men. They're referring to Big Red and, of course, to Bad Leroy Brown. And their parents raised men, there's no question about it. Tommy Rich approaching, and tomorrow night at the Omni.
Excuse me just a minute. All I got to say, you know, Flair, you come out here and you talk like you're God's gift to the women. You think you deserve that belt. To me, it would be an honor to wear that world heavyweight title. The Omni, December the 13th, Flair. You better be ready for one of the dead-gummedest fights he ever been in his life, Gordon, because just like I said, not only will it be an early Christmas present to myself, but I'd love to represent all the people, not just here in Georgia, but all over the country. So, Flair, just like I said, you better be ready because suits don't count. I'm coming to whip you, brother.
Thanks for watching Georgia Championship Wrestling. The announcers on this program are employed by Georgia Championship Wrestling, Incorporated. Join us again next week for Georgia Championship Wrestling.